الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فقال سبحانه وتعالى: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. فقال سبحانه وتعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا يسخر قوم من قوم عسى أن يكونوا خيرا منهم ولا نساء من نساء عسى أن يكن خيرا منهن ولا تلمزوا أنفسكم ولا تنابزوا بالألقاب بئس الاسم الفسوق بعد الإيمان ومن لم يتب فأولئك هم الظالمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن إن بعض ظن إثم ولا تجسسوا ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا أيحب أحدكم أن يأكل لحم أخيه ميتا فكرهتموه واتقوا الله إن الله تواب رحيم. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: أتدرون ما الغيبة؟ قالوا: الله ورسوله أعلم. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: ذكرك أخاك بما يكره. قيل: أرأيت إن كان في أخي ما أقول؟ قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن كان فيه ما تقول فقد اغتبت، وإن لم يكن فيه ما تقول فقد بهت. رواه مسلم وأبو داود والترمذي والنسائي. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن الرجل ليؤتى كتابه منشورا فيقول: يا رب، فإن حسنات كذا وكذا عملتها ليست في صحيفتي، فيقول: محيت باغتيابك الناس. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليكرم ضيفه، ومن كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فلا يؤذي جاره، ومن كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليقل خيرا أو ليصمت. رواه الإمام البخاري في صحيحه. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن من أربى الربا الاستطالة في إرض المسلم بغير حق، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Respected علماء، respected elders, my brothers And my sisters, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My brothers, continuing on with regards to the evils of this flesh that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed between the cheeks and inside the mouth, the tongue. And I mentioned that this flesh is so powerful. So powerful that one word which you may think nothing of, this one word may prove so powerful and so fatal on the day of judgment. كَيَرْفَعُ اللَّهُ بِهَا دَرَجَاتِ That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of this one word, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise your ranks in Jannah. And this piece of flesh is so powerful. So powerful that just one word from the displeasure of the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this one word may prove so fatal on the day of judgment that the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala فَيَحْوِي بِهَا فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمْ On the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may decide because of this one word that you are to go into the depths of hell. And I made a mention of one of these sins that this flesh commits, and that was taking mick and making fun out of the people. And I made a mention that this is a sin that we all commit to some extent. Our elders commit this sin, and even our youngsters at the age of 8 and 9 commit this sin. Majority of the sins are committed by this piece of flesh. And moving on to a sin that nearly everybody commits. Everybody commits, إِلَّا مَنْ أَصِمَ رَبُّكَ The young, the old, the small, the big, the learned, the non-learned, the male, the female, everyone to some extent or another, إِلَّا مَنْ أَصِمَ رَبُّكَ except those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has saved. Everyone to some extent commit this sin. And yet again, it is a sin of this tongue. And this sin is called backbiting. Talking evil about somebody. And we commit this sin day and night without even realizing, without even considering it a sin. Even in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we come to the masjid and we are waiting for salah, instead of making zikr, instead of remembering the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, instead of reciting the Quran, instead of sending salutations on Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sending durood upon our beloved Nabi, we will sit against the radiators. And there you will find that we are talking and we are backbiting somebody, we are talking evil about somebody. Even in the days of Hajj, in the holy cities of Makkah al-Mukarramah and Madinah al-Munawwara, even in the state of Ihram, when we are wearing the pure white sheets, you will find that we are having a go at some Saudi official or our group leader. We commit this sin day in, day out. And on top of this, which is even worse, is that we justify our ghibat. We justify this sin that we commit by saying that we are speaking the truth. What we are saying is exactly in the person that whom we are talking about. And we don't just say it behind his back. We can confront him with this sin. We can say it on his face. And many a time we have said it on his face. This is exactly what ghibat is. This is exactly what this sin is. Whether you say it on his face or whether you say it behind his back, it is called ghibat. Especially, it is called ghibat. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once asked the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, O my Sahaba, atadruna mal ghibat? O my Sahaba, do you know what ghibat is? Do you know what backbiting is? The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een replied, Ki Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam. That Allah and His Messenger Muhammad Rasulullah salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi know best. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ذِكْرُكَ أَخَاكَ بِمَا يَحْكِرَهُ. To make a mention of your brother in a manner which displeases him. To say something about your brother which your brother dislikes. This is ghibat. Whether you say it in front of his face or whether you say it when he's not there, in his absence, behind his back. If it is something that if your brother was to come to know of this and he would dislike this, then this is what ghibat is. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in asked, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ki ara'ayta in kana fi akhi ma aqul? If what I'm saying with regards to my brother, the thing I have mentioned with regards to my brother, if this thing is inside my brother, this sifat that I have mentioned, my brother has this inside him, will it still be classed as ghibat? Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, كَإِنْ كَانَ فِيهِ مَا تَقُولُ فَقَدْ اِكْتَبْتَ وَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ فِيهِ مَا تَقُولُ فَقَدْ بَهَتَ. That if this thing that you have mentioned with regards to your brother, if this thing is inside your brother, then this is exactly what ghibat is. And if this thing is not inside your brother, and you have said something with regards to your brother, which your brother is pure of, then you have committed a sin even bigger than ghibat, then you have committed the sin of buhtan, which is far greater than the sin of ghibat. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam disliked this sin so much that on one occasion Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was on a journey with the Azwaj Mutahharat, with the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with our mothers. Now Hazrat Safiya radiallahu ta'ala anha's camel fell sick, and our mother Hazrat Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha had a spare camel, had an extra one. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Sayyidina Zainab, "A'tiha ba'ira," that the spare camel you have, give it to Hazrat Safiya radiallahu ta'ala anha. Now our mother Hazrat Safiya radiallahu ta'ala anha was of Jewish origin, from the progeny of the great prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Sayyidina Musa and Sayyidina Harun alayhim as-salah. When Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Zainab to give her this camel, she replied, O Messenger of Allah, ana u'ti tilka al-yahudiyya? Shall I give it to that Yahudiya? Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam disliked this comment of hers so much. Though in reality our mother Hazrat Safiya, this was her origin. Our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam disliked this remark so much that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stopped speaking to our mother Hazrat Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha for over 2 months. He did not speak to her in the month of Zilhijjah. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not speak to her in the month of Muharram. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not speak to her in some days of Safar. And why not? Because he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one that has said, إِنَّ مِنْ أَرْضَ الرِّبَا الْإِسْتِطَالَةَ فِي إِرْضِ الْمُسْلِمِ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ. We know how big of a sin taking and giving interest is. We know that one penny that a person gives in interest, or one penny he receives as interest, this is worse than committing adultery with one's mother. Not once, not 10, 36 times. 36 times a person commits adultery with his mother. Put this sin in one part of the balance, and one penny of interest in the other part of balance, then this one penny of interest that a person has given or taken is worse than this sin of adultery with your mother 36 times. It is such a sin that the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, Allah and His Messenger has declared war with this person. And there are very few sins regarding which Allah and His Messenger Muhammad Rasulullah salawatullah alayhi has declared war. Now Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, emphasizing how big this sin of ghibat is, has said, إِنَّ مِنْ أَرْضَ الرِّبَا الْإِسْتِطَالَةِ فِي إِرْضِ الْمُسْلِمِ بَغَيْرِ حَقٍ, that one of the biggest types of sood, that one of the biggest types of riba is this sin of backbiting, is to say something about your brother which he may dislike. The Quran goes a step further. The Quran relates that this sin of ghibat is as equal to eating the flesh of your Muslim brother that has passed away. Eating the flesh of a dead Muslim brother. The Quran says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمُنُوا جَتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْدَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٍ. ولا تجسسوا ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا أيحب أحدكم أن يأكل لحم أخيه ميتا فكرهتموه واتقوا الله إن الله تواب رحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا or you who believe اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن avoid much suspicion. Why? إن بعض الظن إثم. Indeed some suspicions are sin. ولا تجسسوا and do not spy. ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا and do not backbite one another. أيحب أحدكم أن يأكل لحم أخيه ميتا؟ Would you like to eat the flesh of your dead brother? فكرهتموه. You would hate this and you would dislike this. Just like you would dislike this. So hate backbiting. واتقوا الله إن الله تواب الرحيم. And fear the Almighty Allah. Verily Allah is the one who forgives. And verily Allah is the one who accepts the tawbah. Verily Allah is the one who accepts the repentance. Hazrat Buraida radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates that once Sayyidina Ma'is ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu came to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, tahirni. O Messenger of Allah, purify me. He had committed the sin of adultery. And indirectly he was saying, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, purify me from my sin. O Messenger of Allah, I know when one receives the punishment of the sin that he has committed, one becomes pure from that sin, one becomes free from that sin is wiped away from his account. O Messenger of Allah, I know that the punishment of my sin is death by stoning. Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, kill me. O Messenger of Allah, stone me to death. And O Messenger of Allah, purify me from my sin. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Waihak, irji. فاستغفر الله وتوب عليه. Woe to you. Return to Allah. Beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. Seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive. The hadith states, فرجع غير بعيد. Sayyidina Ma'iz ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu returns. He takes a few steps, a couple of steps. He feels so bitter. He feels so dirty inside. He feels so remorse that he cannot bear to live with this sin. And he turns back to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says, O Messenger of Allah, tahirni. O Messenger of Allah, I beg you, purify me from this sin. O Messenger of Allah, I know that one becomes pure from the sin that he has committed once he receives the punishment of this sin. O Messenger of Allah, I know that the punishment of my sin is death by stoning. Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, I beg you, stone me to death. I beg you, implement the punishment of my sin on me. O no, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, purify me from my sin. Yet again, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Waihak, irji, fastaghfirillah wa tub ilayh. O Ma'is, woe to you. O Ma'is, turn to Allah. O Ma'is, ask Allah for forgiveness. Turn to Allah and beg the Almighty Allah for His mercy and the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive. Yet again, after listening to what Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Sayyidina Ma'is ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu returns. Yet again, he takes a few steps. He takes a few steps and he feels so guilty. He feels so bitter. He feels so remorse, he feels so bad from the inside that he cannot bear to live with this sin. And yet again he turns to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and says, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, purify me. He comes back for a third time and yet again Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Waihak, irji, fastaghfirillah wa tub alayh. O Ma'iz, turn to Allah. O Ma'iz, beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. The Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept. Yet again he returns, yet again he cannot live with this sin, that he turns back to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the fourth time and he says, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, tahirni, O Messenger of Allah, purify me from my sin. How pure these people were. Wallahi, I cannot comprehend how these people were. Look how pure these people were, that he keeps on turning to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he keeps on returning to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he cannot bear to live with this sin. He wants to be purified from this sin. And when Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the fourth occasion, when he says to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya O Messenger of Allah, purify me. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks, O Maiz, Fima utahiru? O Maiz, you want me to purify you? What shall I purify you from? And he replies, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Min al-zina, O Messenger of Allah, purify me from the sin of adultery. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to the Sahaba, Ya Abihi Janoon? Is he insane? Is his mind intact? Is his brain working properly? Is he in the right frame of mind? Does he know what he's saying? Does he know the consequence of what he's saying? The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in informed Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam annahu laysa bimajnoon, that Ma'iz ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu is not insane. His brain is working. Oh Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ma'iz knows the consequence of what he is saying. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, ashariba khamra? Has he taken intoxicants? Has he drunk alcohol? Is he all there? One of the Sahabis stood and smelt him, فَلَمْ يَجِدْ مِنْهُ رِيَا خَمْرَ, and he could not smell any alcohol, and he said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ma'iz ibn Malik is all there, Ma'iz ibn Malik has not taken any intoxicants. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked, أَزَنَيْتَ? O Ma'iz waqi'i, in reality, have you committed this sin of zina? Ma'iz ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu replied in the affirmative. And the law of Allah was passed, and the order was passed, and he was taken to a place called Harra, and Sayyidina Ma'iz ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu was stoned. The hadith states, فَلَمَّا وَجَدَ مَصَّ الْحِجَارَ فَرَّ يَشْتَدْ حَتَّى مَرَّ بِرَجُلٍ مَعَهُ لَحْيُ جَمَلْ فَضَرَبَهُ بِهِ وَضَرَبَهُ النَّاسِ حَتَّى مَعَدْ. He was taken to the place of Harra, and the people began to stone him. And he, when he felt the stones hitting him, and when he felt the pain, naturally, Sayyidina Ma'iz ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu began to run. He began to run, and the people chased him, and he passed a man that was carrying the cheekbones of a camel. This man hit him with this cheekbone, and the people hit him till Sayyidina Ma'iz ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu was no more. He had left this world. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in informed Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he felt the stones, when he felt the pain, he began to run. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, Halla taraktumhu? Only if you had left him when he began to run, it is possible that he would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Almighty Allah would have accepted his repentance. The Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have forgiven him. 2-3 days pass, and Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to the Sahaba, Istaghfiru li Ma'iz ibn Malik, Lakattaba thawbatan law qusimat bayna ummatin lawasiatuh. O my Sahaba, pray for Ma'iz ibn Malik. By Allah, he has made such a repentance, he has made such a tawbah, that if this tawbah, if this repentance was distributed amongst a ummah, was distributed amongst a people, amongst a nation, then this repentance would have sufficed them, and the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of this one repentance, would have forgiven them. Then came the woman of Ghamid, and she said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, purify me. Ya Rasulullah, tahirni. O Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, purify me from the sin I committed. Look how pure these people were. She cannot bear to live with the sin that they have committed, that she comes to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she wants to be purified from this sin. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to her exactly the same words that he said to Sayyidina Ma'iz ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala an, Ki irji'i fastaghfirillah wa tubi ilayhi. That turn to Allah, ask Allah for forgiveness. The Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Arhamur Rahimeen, is the most merciful and the most kind. Turn to Allah and Allah will forgive. And she said to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, Turid an turaddidani kama radatta Ma'iz ibn Malik? O Messenger of Allah, do you want to send me back today just like you sent Ma'iz ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu back? She had been conceived through adultery. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to her, Ki anti, are you the one? She replied, Na, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ki I am the one. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent her back and said, return after you have given birth to the child. Months pass, and she returns carrying her child after she's given birth. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on seeing the child, says, "Idhabi fardi'ihi," that go and feed the child, sukun the child. When the child is no longer in need of you, then return. Yet again months pass, and she comes to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yet again, carrying her child. This time there is a piece of bread in her child's hand, and she says, "Ya Nabi Allah, kad fatamtuhu, O Messenger of Allah, I have suckled this child. This child is no longer in need of me. This child can now eat himself." The child was given to one of the believers to look after, and the law of Allah was passed, and a hole was dug in the ground. She was made to stand inside this hole, and she was stoned till she was no more. Now the main reason for relating this incident was that whilst this incident of Hazrat Mu'adh ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu was taking place, one of the narrations suggests, فَسَمِعَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ رَجُلَيْنِ مِنَ الْأَنصَارِ يُقُولُ أَحَدُهُمَ لِسَاحِبِهِ. The Nabi Kareem صلى الله عليه وسلم overheard two men from the Ansar. One was saying to the other, كَأُنظُرْ إِلَى هَذَا الَّذِي سَطَرَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ فَلَمْ يَدَعْ نَفْسَ حَتَّى رُجِمَ رَجْمُ الْكَلْبِ. Look at this person, what type of person was he? That he committed a sin. The Almighty Allah concealed his sin, kept it hidden. Nobody knew that Mu'adh ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala had committed this sin besides him and the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He came to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He revealed his sin. He told Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the sin that he committed. The law of Allah was implemented, and then he was stoned to death like a dog. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time remained quiet, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not say a thing. After the incident, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took a walk, and the Sahaba walked, and they passed the corpse of a donkey, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Ka'ayna fulan wa fulan," where is so and so, referring to those to the two men of Ansar that had made this comment. They replied, "Nahnu dha ya Rasulullah," sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "O Messenger of Allah, here we are." Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, pointing towards this donkey, said, "Kula min jifati hadhal himar," eat from the flesh of this dead donkey. And they replied, "Ya Rasulullah, ghafar Allahu lak man yakulu min hadha." O Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who will eat from the dead? Who will eat from the flesh of this dead donkey? Even those that are hungry will not eat from the flesh of this dead donkey. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained that the words that you said with regards to your brother, the remarks you made with regards to Sayyidina Mu'adh ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they are far greater in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, far worse than eating the flesh of this dead donkey. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what he said in the Quran, فَأَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِحْتَمُوهُ. That would one of you like to eat the flesh of your dead brother? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave an example of this at the time of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Give what he meant when he was referring to this. Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates a hadith that ka'amara Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam an-nasa bisawmi yawmin, that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on one occasion ordered the sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'een to fast. At the same time, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam declared, كَلَا يُفْتِرَنَّ أَحَدٌ مِّنْكُمْ حَتَّى آذَنَ لَهُ, that nobody is allowed to break their fast, open their fast in the evening, till I myself give them permission. فَصَامَ النَّاسِ حَتَّى إِذَا أَمْسَوْا فَجَعَلَ رَجُلْ يَجِيءُ فَيَقُولُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam إِنِّي زَلْتُ صَائِمًا فَأَذِنِّي. And the people fasted on that day. Come evening, and the people would come to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one by one, and they would say, "Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, that I have been fasting all day. I would be grateful if you can give me permission." Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would give them permission, and they would break their fast. Like this, one after the other, they came, and Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would give them permission. Till one man came and said, "Ya Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, there are two women. They have been fasting all day. but they are ashamed to come to you and take permission. I would be grateful if you can give them permission so that they can also break their fast and open their fast like the people. فَأَعْرَضَ عَنْ Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam turned his blessed face away. The man came again, and yet again he said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they are ashamed to come to you. I would be grateful if you can give them permission. Yet again the hadith states, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam turned his face the other way. He came for a third time, and for a third time Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam turned his face away. He came for a fourth time, and Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إِنَّهُمْ لَمْ يَسُومَا وَكَيْفَ صَامَ مَنْ ظَلَّ حَذَا الْيَوْمْ يَأْكُلُ لُحُومَ النَّاسِ That they have not fasted. And how can one be considered as fasting that has been eating the flesh of the people during the day? Referring to backbiting, referring to ghibat, referring to talking evil about the people. With regards to this incident in the hadith of Hazrat Ubayd radiallahu ta'ala anhu, it is mentioned that the man came and said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that these two women are on the verge of dying out of thirst. Yet again Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam turned his face away. He turned his face away a couple of times, and then he sallallahu alayhi wasallam finally said, call the two women. Call the two women. And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam asked for a large bowl. The women came, and Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam told one of the women to vomit inside this bowl. She vomited, and literally blood, pus, and pieces of flesh came out of her mouth till half of the bowl was filled. Then he sallallahu alayhi wasallam told the other woman to vomit, and she vomited, and yet again blood came out of her mouth, pus came out of her mouth, and pieces of flesh came out of her mouth till this bowl was full. And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, I swear by the one in whose hands my life is in, if this had remained in their stomachs, then the fire of hell would have eaten these women. Allahu Akbar. How fortunate we are that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala conceals our sins, and we do not vomit in this manner. How many times do we commit this sin in one day? How many times do we badmouth our brothers, badmouth our sisters, badmouth our relations, whether it's through jealousy, whether it's through hatred, whether it's through rivalry? Yet we don't even realize that one of the causes of the punishment in the grave is this sin. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned, generally a person receives punishment in the grave for three reasons. One of the reasons mentioned in that hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is ghibah. Hazrat Abu Umama radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, Ja'ata an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wasallam baqi' al-qabr. Once Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam came to al-baqi', the grave of the Muslims in Madinah Munawwara, and he sallallahu alayhi wasallam stood next to two fresh graves, and he sallallahu alayhi wasallam asked, Adafantum fulanan wa fulan? Here, have you buried so and so and so and so? The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in replied the affirmative, Ke ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that we've buried so and so. He sallallahu alayhi wasallam pointing to one of the graves and said, Laqad uqila fulanu al-an, that so and so has just been made to sit in his grave. وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَكَدْ دُرِبَ دَرْبَةً مَا بَقِيَ مِنْهُ أُذْوٌ إِلَّا مْقَفَى وَلَكَدْ تَطَائِرَ قَبْرَهُ نَارًا وَلَكَدْ صَرْخَ صَرْخَةً سَمِعَ الْخَلَائِكِ الَّثَقَلَيْنَ الْإِنْسُ وَالْجِنُ وَلَوْلَا تَمْرِيجٌ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ وَتَزَيُّدُكُمْ فِي الْحَدِيثِ لَسَمِعْتُ مَا أَسْمَعَ I swear by the one in whose hands my life is in, he has just been made to sit, and he has just received such a beating that every limb is broken and his grave is full of fire, and he has made such a cry that the whole of mankind, that the whole of that every creation of Allah besides the humans and jinn have heard his cry. And if it had not been for the jumbleness in your heart and your excessive talk, then you would have heard what I've heard. Then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pointing towards the second grave and said, Yudrab hadha, now the second one is being beaten. Now the second one is being beaten. And I swear by the one in whose hands my life is in, he has received such a beating, كَمَا بَقِيَ مِنْهُ أَغْمُرْ إِلَّا مْقَطَى, that every bone has crackled, every bone has broken, and his grave is full of fire. And he has made such a cry that all the creations have heard his cry, except for mankind and jinn. And if it had not been for the
stillness and the istirab inside your heart and your excessive talk, then you would have also heard what I've heard. When the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala and Majmain heard this, they asked, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, وَمَا ذَنْبُهُمَا, what is the sin that they have committed? Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, كَأَمَّا فُلَان فَإِنَّهُ كَانَ لَا يَسْتَبْرِئُ مِنَ الْبَوْلِ, that one of the two, he would not take precautions at the time of urinating. Majority of us also commit this sin, and majority of us are unaware of how to make the istinja according to sunnah and how to make istibra. And for those that do not know what is istibra and how to make the istinja according to sunnah, then they should refer to their ulama and they should ask them how to make istibra, because this is also one of the causes of the punishment in our grave. And I would say at least 90%, even those people that come to the masajid and read their prayers, are not aware of this masala. As for the second, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, فَإِنَّهُ كَانَ يَأْكُلُ لُحُومَ النَّاسِ, the reason that he is receiving punishment in the grave is that because he would eat the flesh of the people, he would backbite and he would talk evil about his brothers. And in another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then asked for a green branch of a date palm. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam split it into two pieces, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam planted one on each branch and said, it is hoped that their punishment be abated till these two pieces of branch get dried. Jalaluddin Suyuti rahmatullah alayhi relates in his work Sharh al-Sudur fi Ahwal al-Mawta wal-Qubur, that once a woman died, her brother, after burying her, returned home. Now as he returns home, he remembers that he has left a bag inside the grave. He returns to take out this bag. He opens a small portion of the grave, and what does he see? He sees that the grave is full of fire and his sister is being punished inside the grave. He immediately closes the grave and returns to his mother and relates what he had seen. He then asks his mother, what could be the cause of my sister receiving punishment inside the grave? His mother mentioned that his sister was a good woman. The only fault that she had inside her was that she would delay her salah, and she had the habit of backbiting and slandering, and it's most probable that she is receiving this punishment in the grave because of this. My brothers and sisters, if this is the grave, and if this is one of the causes of the punishment of the grave, then I ask, what do you think awaits us in the next life? What do you think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has store for these people that commit this sin in the next life? Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كَأَرْبَعَةٌ يُؤْذُونَ أَهْلَ النَّارِ عَلَى مَا بِهِمْ مِنَ الْعَذَارِ يَسْعَوْنَ مَا بَيْنَ الْحَمِيمِ وَالْجَحِيمِ يَدْعُونَ بِالْلَّيْلِ وَالسَّبُورِ, that there will be four types of people that they will be giving taklif, they will be troubling the people of hell. The people of hell will be receiving their punishment, and on top of this, they will be troubled by these four types of people. And these people will run between Hamim and Jahim, يَدْعُونَ بِالْلَّيْلِ وَالسَّبُورِ, and they will be begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for death. The people of death will say to one another, كِمَا بَالُ هَؤُلَاءِ كَدْ آذَوْنَ عَلَى مَا بِنَا مِنَ الْأَذَاءِ, what's the score with these people that we are already receiving punishment, we are already being troubled with our punishment, and on top of this we are being troubled by these people? One of the four that has been mentioned is a person that will have a collar of fire around his neck. وَرَجُلٌ يَجُرُ أَمْعَاءَ, another will be dragging his and pulling his intestines. The third, blood and pus will flow from his face. وَرَجُلٌ يَأْكُلُ لَحْمَ, and the fourth will be eating his own flesh. And this one that will be eating his own flesh will be the one who was backbiting in the dunya. And in some narration and in some hadith it is mentioned that these people will have nails of copper, and they will be digging it into their own flesh, and they will be scratching themselves, and they will be digging their own flesh out. My brothers and sisters, this is why we need to refrain from this sin at this moment in time. We need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us. And further, we need to seek pardon from the person we have backbited to the best of our ability. And if we cannot find him, or we do not know of his whereabouts, إِنَّ مِنْ كَفَّارَةِ الْغِيبَةِ أَن تَسْتَغْفِرَ لِمَنْ اِخْتَبْتَ يَقُولْ اللَّهُمَ اغْفِرْ لَنَا وَلَا, then we need to make dua maghfirat for that person. First of all, we need to ask him directly. If we cannot find him or do not know where he is about, then we should make dua maghfirat for that person. We should pray to that person that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Because if we don't do this, We will find on the day of judgment that this ghibat, that this sin of ghibat, that this sin of backbiting has eaten all our teeth. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, "Ya adadruna mal muflis?" O my Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, do you know who a muflis is? Now the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, according to their own understanding of a muflis, according to the definitions of a muflis with regards to the dunyavi matters, they answered, "Ke ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ke a muflis is that person, ke man la dirham ala wala mata." That a muflis is that person who has no dirham, who has no wealth, who has no property. He's a poor person. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, "Ka'inna al-muflis min ummati man ya'ti yawm al-qiyamati bi salatin wa siyamin wa zakatin, walakin ya'ti kashatama hadha wa kazafa hadha wa akla maala hadha wa safaka dama hadha wa daraba hadha." That a muflis from amongst my ummah will be that person who will come on the day of judgment with many salat, with many fasts, with many zakat, but at the same time he will have come with all these good deeds, but at the same time he will have accused this person, he will have sworn to another one, he will have cursed a third, he will have taken mick out of the fourth, he would have ate the wealth of the fifth. And all these people will be waiting in a line on the day of judgment, and they will want justice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَيُوتَ حَاذَ مِنْ حَسَنَاتِ وَحَاذَ مِنْ حَسَنَاتِ. And they will come to Allah and they will ask for justice, and they will take away his good deeds. One by one they will come, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him some, will give one of them some of his good deeds. The other will come, Allah will give him some of his good deeds. A third will come, Allah will give some of his good deeds. Like this he will find all the namazes that he had read, all the zakat that he had given, all the people that he had helped, all the donations that he had given, and the deeds that he had received, the good deeds that he received for and the thawab that he had received for these good deeds, he will find that these people have taken all his thawab. Yet he'll still find that the people are waiting in the queue and they want justice. And now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take the sins of these people and he will throw it onto this man. One by one they will come and they will throw their sins onto this man, till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will decide, فَطُرِحَتْ عَلَيْهِ ثُمَّ طُرِحَ فِي النَّارِ, that he will be thrown into the fire of hell. This is why when the great Hassan al-Basri rahmatullah alayhi was told that a man was speaking evil of him, was backbiting him, the great Hassan al-Basri rahmatullah alayhi sent him a tray full of dates, saying that, "I have heard that you have sent me your good deeds, you have sent me your virtues. I send you in exchange this small present of dates, and I ask forgiveness that I could not give its full exchange. And it's because of this our elders would refrain from committing this sin." The Saint Ibrahim ibn Adam rahmatullah alayhi was a very pious saint of his time. Once he was invited for a meal. When they sat down to eat, the people asked, "Where is so and so?" Now one of those that was present, that he replied, "Okay, that man is fat, and it's because of this he's probably delayed." Ibrahim ibn Adam rahmatullah alayhi immediately left the majlis, the gathering, and he began to have a go at his nafs, that if you had not, that it's because of you today that I have listened to this ghibat and I have committed the sin of listening to ghibat. If you had not been hungry, then we would not have come to this invitation, we would not have come to this dawah. And if we hadn't come to this dawah, we would not have listened to this ghibat. Then he had such a go at his nafs. For the next 20 days consecutively, Ibrahim ibn Adam rahmatullah alayhi stayed hungry and he did not eat a thing. I'm sure by now you've understood why Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "كَمَنْ يَضْمَنْ لِي مَا بَيْنَ لِحْيَيْهِ وَمَا بَيْنَ فَخِذَيْهِ أَضْمُ اللَّهُ الْجَنَّةِ." Whoever gives me guarantee of that thing that is between his cheeks, that he will safeguard his tongue, he will not use his tongue in the wrong manner, ay Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will give him the guarantee of Jannah. Majority of the sins are committed by this tongue. Lying, taking mick, slandering, backbiting, breaking promises, cursing, you name it, false accusation, and you will find that the majority of the sins that are committed by this piece of flesh that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed between your cheeks. The reason, this is a blessing of Allah, this piece of flesh is a blessing of Allah, and the reason the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this tongue, gave us this blessing, was that so that we only use it for two reasons. We either use it to benefit ourselves, or we use it to benefit others. Benefit ourselves by being able to express what is inside our hearts, and at the same time making the zikr of Allah and remembering the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why when a Sahabi came to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ki ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ki inna shara'i al-Islami kad kathurat. Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ki there are many different things in Islam. And he wasn't referring to the faraid, those things that are compulsory. Nor was he referring to the sunnah. He was referring to the mustahabbat. That there are many things that are desirable in Islam, that if one does, he will be rewarded. And it is impossible for a person to act upon all the mustahabbat. So he said, Ki ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, referring to the mustahabbat, Ki ya Rasulullah, there are many things which are desirable in Islam, and for me to act upon everyone is very difficult. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inform me of just one thing which I can hold firm and act upon regularly. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, Ki make sure this tongue of yours is also, is always remembering the Almighty Allah, is always making the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is one reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this tongue, so that we use it to benefit ourselves. And the second reason, لا خير في كثير من نجواهم إلا من أمر بصدقة أو معروف أو إصلاح بين الناس. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this tongue that we benefit others. We teach others good things. We teach others the Quran. We teach others the hadith of Rasulullah. We tell others to do good things. We enjoy good. We forbid evil. If two brothers are not getting on with one another, we make salah between them. We make them friends, and we bring peace between them. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this tongue. And our elders would use it in this manner. The saint Sayyidina Rabi, for 20 years he did not speak and make a mention of the dunya. He would keep a piece of paper in front of him. And only at the time of dire need, if he had to say something, even then he would write it on the piece of paper. The great Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak relates. He relates that on one of my journeys to Hajj, from a distance I saw something black. When I got close there, I saw it was an old woman. I greeted her with Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakat. And this old woman, given an answer to my salam, she replied from the verse of the Quran, giving an answer, Salamun qawlam min rabbir raheem. I asked her, Ki yarhamukillah, Ki Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on you. كما تصنعين في هذا المكان. كي what are you doing in this place? Yet again she replies from the verse of the Quran, reciting the verse of the Quran, كي ومن يدلل الله فما له من هاد. كي whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lead astray, that nobody can guide that person. He says from this verse of the Quran, I realized that this old woman was lost. And I asked her, كأين تريدين? Where do you intend to go? Yet again she replies from the verse of the Quran, سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى. He glorified is the one who took his servant in part of a night from Masjid al-Haram to Masjid al-Aqsa. He says from this verse of the Quran, I realize that she has already been to Masjid al-Haram, she has already done her Hajj, and now she is making her way to the third Haram, to Masjid al-Aqsa. I asked, أنت منذ كم في هذا الموضع? That how long have you been sitting here and have been in this place? And she replied yet again from the verse of the Quran, ثلاث ليال سوية, that I have been here for 3 consecutive nights. I said to her, yeah, I don't see any food and drink with you. What do you eat? And yet again she replies from the verse of the Quran, هُوَ يُطْئِمُنِي وَيَسْقِينِي, that the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives me food, and the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives me drink. I asked, فَبِأَيِّ شَيْءٍ تَدْوَضَّئِينَ, what do you make your wuzu from? And she replied yet again from the Quran, فَإِنْ لَمْ تَجِدُ مَاءً فَتَيَمَّمُ صَيِّدًا طَيِّبًا, that if you cannot find water, then make tayammum with the earth. I asked, that I have some food with me, would you like to eat? This time she recited the verse of the Quran, that complete your fast till the night. And from this I realized that she is fasting. I said to her, okay, do you know when a person is on a journey, it is permissible for him not to fast? Allah has given rukhsa, Allah has made it easy. This time she recites the verse of the Quran saying, وَأَن تَسُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ, that if you fast, it is better for you. Now every answer she was giving was from the Quran. She was reciting the verse of the Quran. So I said to her, لِمَا لَا تُكَلِّمِينَنِي مِثْلُ مَا أُكَلِّمُكَ, Why do you not speak to me in the manner that I'm speaking to you? Yet again she recites a verse of the Quran, مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيمٌ عَتِيدٌ. He and she does not utter one single word except there are angels waiting to record this word. I then ask, فَمِنْ أَيِّ النَّاسِ أَنْتِ. Which people are you from? And she replied from the verse of the Quran, وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ أَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا. Say not of which you have no knowledge. Verily the hearing, the sight, the heart, everything will be questioned on the day of judgment. I said, I've made a mistake, forgive me. This time she recites the verse of the Quran, لَا تَصْرِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْيَوْمَ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. There is no reproach on you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive you. I asked, will you allow me to mount you on my camel so we can quickly catch the caravan? She replied yet again from the verse of the Quran, وَمَا تَفْعَلُ مِنْ خَيْرٍ يَعْلَمُ اللَّهُ. Whatever good you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows of it. From this I realized that she's agreed, and I made my camel sit. And she said this time, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُدُّ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. Tell the believers to lower their gaze. And I lowered my gaze, and she mounted. As she was about to mount, the she-camel made haste, and her clothes ripped. And she recited the verse of the Quran, وَمَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ. That every calamity that you are afflicted with is due to your deeds. She mounted, reciting the dua yet again from the Quran, سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي سَخَّرَ لَنَا هَذَا وَمَا كُنَّا لَهُ مُقْرِنِينَ وَإِنَّا إِلَىٰ رَبِّنَا لَمُنْقَلِبُونَ. I took the rein of the camel, and I began to run and shout. This time she recites the verse of the Quran, وَاكْسِذْ فِي مَشِّكْ وَغْضُمْ مِنْ صَوْتِكْ. That be moderate in your walking and lower your voice. I began to walk slowly, and this time I began to recite poetry just to keep myself occupied. And she says yet again from the Quran, فَقْرَأُ مَا تَيَسَّرَ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. Read whatever's easy from the Quran. I said to this woman, كِأُوْتِيْتِ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. That you have been given a lot of good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed you. Yet again she replies from the verse of the Quran, كَوَمَا يَذَّكَّرُ إِلَّا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. Can none receive admonition, none receive nasihat, except men of understanding. He says, I began to walk slowly. And after a while I asked, do you have a husband? And this time she relates the verse of the Quran, كَيَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَسْلُوا أَنَا شَيَا إِن تُبْدَلَكُمْ تَسُؤْكُمْ. Hinting that I shouldn't be asking with regards to things like this. He says, I remained quiet, and I did not speak to her thereafter till we reached the caravan. When we reached the caravan, I asked who she had come with and who was inside that caravan that was related to her. And she recited the verse of the Quran, كَالْمَالُ وَالْبَنُونَ زِينَةُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. That this wealth and these children are the zenith of this dunyavi life. And I understood from this that she has children. And then I asked her, كَوْمَا شَأْنُهُمْ فِي الْحَجِ. What are they doing on Hajj? This time she recites the verse of the Quran, وَعَلَامَاتِ وَبِالنَّجْمِهُمْ يَحْتَدُونَ. And I realized from this that they were guides, and they were guiding this caravan towards Baytul Maqdis, towards the third Haram. Thus I went right to the front, and I asked, what are their names? This time she recites the verses of the Quran, وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا يَا يَحْيَ خُذِ الْكِتَابَ بِكُوَّةٍ. And I realized that their names were Ibrahim, Musa, Yahya. I called, Ya Ibrahim, Ya Musa, Ya Yahya. And before I know it, there are three youngsters before me. Their faces are beautiful as the moon. And she says to her children, yet again reciting a verse of the Quran, إِبْعَثُ أَحَدَكُمْ بِوَرِقِكُمْ هَذِهِ إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَيُّهَا أَزْكَى طَعَامًا فَلْيَأْتِكُمْ بِرِزْقٍ مِّنْ. That go, one of you fetch food. One of them goes and fetches food and presents it before me. And she says yet again from the verse of the Quran, كُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا حَنِيئًا بِمَا أَسْرَفْتُمْ فِي الْأَيَّامِ الْخَالِيَةِ. To eat and drink. And I said to the children, كَالْآن طَعَامُكُمْ عَلَيَّ حَرَامًا حَتَّى تُخْبِرُونِي بِأَمْرِهَا. That your food is haram on me, and I will not eat your food till you inform me with regards to this person. And they informed him, كَهَذِهِ أُمُّنَا. That this is our mother. For 40 years she has not spoken except from the Quran. She has not said a single word outside the Quran. Anything that we ask, anything she has to say, she will recite a verse of the Quran, fearing that she may say one word from the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and her abode will become the fire of hell. It is exactly the hadith of Rasulullah. Inna al-abd la yatakallamu bil kalima. Sometimes a person utters a word from the pleasure of Allah. He doesn't think much about this word, but this word proves to be so powerful in the eyes of Allah that because of this, his ranks are raised in paradise. Wa inna al-abd la yatakallamu bil kalima min sakhatillah. And sometimes a person says a word from the displeasure of Allah. He thinks nothing of this word, but this word proves so powerful in the eyes of Allah that because of this, he is thrown into the fire of hell. So for 40 years, she protected her tongue. She safeguarded her tongue, fearing that she may utter one word that proves so fatal that because of this, that she becomes the inhabitant of hell. And because of this, she would recite her Quran and talk from the Quran and give answers from the Quran. The great Abdullah ibn Mubarak replies, ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِيهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ ذُو الْفَضْلِ الْعَظِيمِ. Waqi, that is the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives this to whoever He wishes. These were our elders. And this is the reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this tongue. That we either benefit ourselves by being able to say what is inside our heart, express what is inside our heart, and by remembering the Almighty Allah, by reciting the Quran, or by benefit others, by teaching others good, by teaching them the Quran, by teaching them the Hadith, by telling them to do good things, enjoining good and forbidden evil. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this blessing. And if we cannot benefit ourselves, and if we cannot benefit others with this tongue, then we should remain silent. Even in our remaining silent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward us. Dawood ibn al-Madini was once asked, لِمَا لَا تَتَكَلَّمْ? Why do you not speak? He remained quiet. And after a long time, he raised his head as if he wasn't there. Yet again he was questioning, do you not speak? Why do you not speak? Or is it that you cannot speak? This time he answers, كِأَنْتَظِرْ رَسُولَ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. I am waiting for the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, referring to the angel of death. وَأَنَا مُفَكِّرٌ فِي الْجَوَابِ. And I'm thinking of an answer to give him. And one who is occupied with things like this, how can he find time to speak? Kharijat ibn Mus'ab relates that I stayed with Ibn Aun for 12 years. Not once did I ever hear him utter one single word which the angels may have written against him. My brothers, these were our elders, and we should follow their example. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this tongue, that we either benefit ourselves or we benefit others. And if we cannot do this, then we should remain silent. At least that way, nothing is written against us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give me the tawfiq to act upon what I have said. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give you the tawfiq to act upon what has been said. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.